I would like to open our third day. Our present keynote speaker is Christina Hoek, who is a full professor in interaction design at the Royal Institute of Technology in Stockholm. Professor Hoek has obtained numerous grants, national and international grants, awards, and fellowships. Her magnum opus so far appeared at MIT Press in 2018, entitled Designing with Body, Somaesthetic Interaction Design. And the present lecture's title is Turning Somaesthetics into an Active Design Stance with Digital Materials.
Thank you.
The floor is yours.
Thank you. Yaha, good morning, everyone. The day after the conference dinner. So, let's get going. So my name is Christina or Kia Hoek, and it's lovely to be in Hungary where you know what the is, because otherwise I'm usually referred to as Hoek, which is not my last name. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we took Richard's project on somaesthetics and turned it into a design stance that we use to create interaction design elements. And we'll see what you say, because maybe this is in some ways quite different from what we heard the previous 2 days. But let me start with a little story. A story that sort of explains the way I see interaction design, what it is and what it does to us. So I was traveling with a friend of mine. We went to a conference, and then afterwards she said, Kia, do you want to join me and come up to the Orkney Islands? And I was like, yay, Orkney Islands, choo-hoo. And as it turns out, my friend, Catherine Isbister, an American, her family came from the Orkney Islands. And so Isbister there is a very common name. And so she was like, yeah, you know, I'd like to see the Orkney Islands and see where my family comes from originally. And so the idea was to go to the Orkney Islands and see some graves where there would be relatives buried. And I was like, yay, Orkney Islands and some graves, that will be amazing. So we went there, and there was in particular one place called the Isbister Tomb. And we're like, yeah, let's go there. And so we went. It was a beautiful day. And as it turned out, this tomb was not really a grave with her ancestors, or maybe it was, but it was 5,000 years old. And so this was one of those graves where they'd found amazing stuff buried, because it was closed. It was used for a long, long time, and then 5,000 years ago, it was just, boom, closed. So all of the stuff was still in there. So we came to this tomb, and we were allowed to go into the tomb ourselves without any guide, which was also amazing, very strange. To a Swedish person, you're like, what, really? We can go into a 5,000-year-old tomb, and nobody is following us? The other thing we got to do was to touch some of the tools that they had found in this tomb. And here is actually my hand holding one of those tools. It's basically a stone, but it has this chipped little thing there that you can see where your thumb fits really nicely. So as you grab this stone, your thumb will be right at the right place. And it immediately makes sense to you. You know, it's like you can see how you would prepare skin or use this tool for other stuff like that. So imagine doing design work that 5,000 years later, somebody can pick up and go like, oh, this makes sense. But not only that, we were also allowed to see some of the skeletons that they had found in this grave. And the skeletons showed that these people were buff. You know, they had big muscles. You could see at the muscle tendons that, you know, they'd been... And of course, if you have tools like this, you have to be pretty strong. And though you all look very healthy and so on, I don't think you're that buff, are you? And I think maybe that is because the tools you use look more like this computer here, right? And so it's mainly training your fingers, maybe bits of your arms, but not really the and so you see this and you go like, yeah, of course, if you have tools that look like this, your body is going to change to fit with the tools. And not only are your muscles going to be, also your nervous system reactions are going to be adjusted to these tools. And also the way you see the world, the way you understand what you can do, will be shaped by these tools, right? And so this is what the responsibility we have as interaction designers, that the tools that we create and put out there, they will change people. They will change their muscles, their nervous system reactions, their outlook on life, what they can do and what they cannot do, and what the culture could be. So that's my dream, isn't it? To build a tool that you can pick up a long, long time from now, and it'll make sense and it will tell you something about what we could do in our time. So, in a way, the way I see it is that we leave these sedimented movements behind in our designs, and then we invite our end users to engage with these movements. And, you know, the way to come to that is, of course, that you have to figure out what kind of movements you want to invite your end users to engage with. Now, to this, we add something that has been discussed for 2 days, namely that Richard said that not only will we be changed by what we do, the body practices we engage with, and so on, we can also improve. So the somesthetic promise is that we should be able to improve. By doing really good design work, then maybe I will be able to invite my end users to also take part in the somesthetic project, maybe. So the way I look upon our work is, you know, not only to train my own body to be able to design interesting designs that develop me and change me in the direction that I want to grow, but also for our future imagined users to invite them into this somesthetic project. But can we? You know, so he promised us this, but is that really possible? So the way an interaction designer thinks about that problem is, well, let's design some stuff and then put it to some users and see what happens over time. So this is what we did. And at the time, this is in 2014 maybe, we were working with IKEA. You know, IKEA is a Swedish company, yes. And so, and it's a lovely company in some ways. And so what they wanted us to do was they wanted to design interactive furniture, because they were seeing that, okay, something is going on with all of these digital interactions entering into everything. So what is going to happen to the IKEA furniture? Is it also going to be interactive? What is that? What does that mean? So that was one aim. They wanted to explore that. And the other aim they had was to look at health. So a lot of IKEA furniture are fun and aesthetically interesting. You can combine them in different ways and create your own personal expression. But beyond that, they also wanted it to promote well-being and to be, you know, good stuff for people. Okay, so how do you even approach that? Well, we invited Richard, and he came. And we engaged in a workshop where we did a lot of Feldenkrais exercises, and we also did design work. And step by step, over a long, long time period, we shaped a bunch of different prototypes. Two of them we took all the way to actually fully functioning systems. So one of them, it's a very simple system. It's basically a lamp. And as you lay underneath this lamp, it will be dimming in the same tempo as you're breathing. So basically, it's a sensor that measures the distance from your chest up to the lamp. So as you lay there and you're breathing in and out, the sensor will register that. And then the lamp is just going to follow your breathing pattern. And so we're not trying to influence the user in any way. You know, we're just trying to follow the breathing, which is interesting because it's suddenly you start deepening your breathing pattern for reasons I don't understand, but you do. And so here you see my friend Johanna laying underneath the lamp, and you can see how she's breathing in and out and how the lamp is dimming in the same tempo. We also created this mat. So remember, we're working with IKEA. We want to do furniture, right? So we do a mat. And this mat is helping you to go through your body. Now, we're talking about Sweden. It's pretty cold most of the time. So what we did was we put heat elements into this mat. And then as you're asked to focus on different body parts,
then your left shoulder,
it heats up underneath those body parts.
Your right hip and your left hip. And now move down to your calves. Can you feel the right calf?
And after a while, the voice stops speaking, and instead you're sort of taken through a journey of experiencing your own body. Okay, so this was all lovely, and we tested it on ourselves, and it was amazing, and everybody loved it, but would it really have the somatic effect of improving on your ability to appreciate, aesthetically appreciate, and become more body aware? So, of course, this is a super complex question to ask. Like, if you produce a system, and in this case, we put it into four households for a long time period, for 3 months, then how do you show any effects that are not to do with whatever else might be going on in their lives, right? You don't know whether it is the system that is achieving the changes or not. And for those of you who do user studies, you know that we can create effects without really doing anything, right? Just raising the light or lowering the light or making somebody feel attended to. Anyway, so we did this study, and to analyze what was going on here, we used new materialism and entanglement theories. I don't know if you read about Tim Ingold's metaphors of knots, lines, and meshwork. It is a better way of seeing what is going on, we think, compared to Barad or compared to Bruno Latour's actor network theories. It's really a lovely way of seeing how we live. So, you know, you have these lines of activities that are going on in your life. Sometimes they meet and a knot is made between these activities, and sometimes they diverge again and so on. And to us, this was a way of analyzing the super rich data we had from 3 months of using these systems in somebody's home. And so it allowed us to see how, you know, life is complex, right? You have work and you have this and you have stress and you have kids and you have a parent that gets ill and whatnot. All of these things make stuff happen, sometimes go in parallel, sometimes tie knots to create meaning in your life. So let me just talk through one of our users' experience. And if you want to read about the whole study, then there is a paper recently presented, like 2 weeks ago. So this is Sarah. She had quite serious problems with headache, and she had pain in her neck, and she was very, very tired. And she, of course, was not stupid. She understood that she needed to do something about it. So she tried physiotherapy, massage, visiting a naturopath, yoga, meditation, qigong, and in general, getting advice from all of these different experts that sort of emphasize that you need to slow down, you need to relax, and you need to increase your awareness of when you get tensed somewhere, right? I think a lot of people in this audience recognize these problems, right? We're all like, oh yeah, should be relaxing that shoulder there. But it didn't work for her. She was the kind of person who walks fast, chup, 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 between activities, back and forth. And she hadn't been able to connect the dots between all of these activities. These were things she tried, they didn't make sense, and it didn't help her. And then throughout the experiment with using the soma mat and the breathing light, she came to see that, right, this is how I need to engage. And so the fact that this installation in her home was making her do stuff regularly and sort of taking a space and having like a short lesson, short enough for her to engage frequently, but long enough for her to understand something. That is where she was like going from this and to instead becoming with. So she says, after using the prototypes for a while, the entire meshwork that Sarah is, you know, gets affected. So it's her choice to engage with Qigong or meditation and whatnot suddenly comes together into an understanding. And this is, in a way, a transformation, a creation of in-between that is formed by these prototypes that allows her to understand all sorts of other stuff. So suddenly, she start walking slower, you know, and her friends would comment on this and they would go like, you're walking so slow these days. And she even started contemplating leaving her apartment in the city center of Stockholm, which is a really cool place to be, and instead buying something further out to sort of harmonize with her understanding of what she needed. And so I don't know if you've been carrying these bracelets that measure your how much you're walking and your heart rate variability and whatever they measure, right? And the thing is that with all of those, there is this rationalization that you have to do. Oh, I'm supposed to walk 10,000 steps a day, right? And I only walked 8,900 today, so that's no good, is it? So how do I engage with that to create something in my life? And the gap between the data you get and the behavior change that you should be doing is huge. It's really, really hard. So I think for here, it's not about understanding, you know, this, that you need to change your behavior, because she knew that you need to relax more or, you know, collect all of this biodata and see these patterns in your life. That is not enough. I think what happened here is another route to the understanding of the change, to understand through your senses, through your soma, what such a change experience feels like. And this is where our participants in the study transformationally become. So this is what we can do, possibly, right? We can create designs that puts us into experiences, or at least invites us into experiences where we can feel what it is to be grounded, and not rationally reason about these 10,000 steps that you're supposed to take or that you're supposed to walk slowly or whatever it is supposed to do, right? Okay, so you delivered. It's not that easy as to say, oh, all you need is a couple of prototypes in your home for 3 months and boom, the somesthetic promise will be delivered. But at least there is some kind of effect. Not only on us as designers, but also on our end users, inviting our end users to feel and experience what it is to be grounded in your own body. Maybe I should tell you another example from this study. It was a 13-year-old girl, very, very shy, and didn't say much, but once asked about her experiences, she said, yeah, I become so confident when I have to present stuff at school, and I'm super nervous about it, I just return to my breathing and I calm down and I can deliver. And it's like, whoa, there you go, like, whoa. And actually, our users cried when we took back the soma mat and the breathing light after the 3 months. Doesn't happen often in a researcher's life. So So let me tell you then, how did we then take this further? Because this was just one design example, and for somebody like me to believe that some aesthetics does indeed work, I need to show that it works repeatedly, that I can address different domains, that I can do design work in all sorts of walks of life. So we did, for example, a breathing guitar. So this is one of my colleagues in Nottingham, Steve Benford. He is a guitar player. He plays folk music. And he came over and we did some design workshops because he said, you know, you get this performance anxiety. And so we were doing all sorts of exercises around this, trying to figure out whether it was to do with the hand, if we could do something around the hands on the instrument, or what we should be doing. And after a while, it became kind of obvious that whenever he was about to play something really difficult, he stopped breathing, right? I do the same when I go horseback riding. When it's really complicated, then I stop breathing. And then my teacher yells at me, "Kia, stop breathing!" You go like, and of course, there's no way of relaxing on a horse or when playing the guitar if you stop breathing, right? So what we did here, we experimented with all sorts of stuff, but one of the variants, we put on these inflatable pillows that will inflate in the same tempo as you're breathing. Or you can also use them, of course, if somebody stops breathing, to sort of gently push a rhythm back in again. So that is what you're seeing. This, the gray and red and blue thing are pillows that inflate. Huh? Cool stuff. I have a colleague from Australia, Josef Ladelfa. He's now a PhD student with us at KTH. He built these amazing drones. You know, otherwise you associate drones with war and horrible things, but he built these beautiful drones that look like water lilies. Here you see one of them. And then he invited people, and you'll see me dancing with these drones. And so I have these things on my hands, and the drone is looking for that. I don't know if you see, it's a very small drone. And that's Joe behind me. So if you look at my movements, it is very much Tai Chi. It's the hips, right? Yeah, so here I'm getting some more instructions on how to move. So fostering that kind of movement with a drone is also kind of interesting. Another example of drones, though, where we actually invited at some point Richard to work with us, was my colleague Åsa Unander-Skarin. She is a dancer and a choreographer, and her husband is a composer, opera composer and singer. And together they wanted to create drones to be used on the opera stage. So they wanted these drones to be singers in the choir, in the Greek choir, for those of you who know opera. So they wanted the drones to have their own voice, to not be completely controlled, to be a bit scary and noisy, and participate in the opera, creating, you know, for as in opera, passion and expression. So be ready for some noise. So these were fairly scary drones. They actually, the engineer who helped build these things, he had a deep cut at one point into his thumb, and it was bleeding for 24 hours. So we had to work a lot with this danger and how close could the drone come to the user. And I think, or to the, in this case, it's Åsa, the dancer, dancing with them. And I think this is what she wanted. She wanted danger, passion, something that is transformative, something that comes close and is dangerous. So we worked on that, and with Richard we later wrote up a paper on the ethics of this, because ethics in a some aesthetic project is about breaking habits, and here Åsa was really keen to break the habits of the opera, the expectations of the opera. In particular, she wanted to empower the diva, which sounds like a contradiction in terms, but the idea is that the diva these days just travels from one opera to another and is given a particular repertoire and doesn't have a lot of power. And here she wanted to be a diva on stage, and that her movements together with the drones would decide what would happen. So empowering the diva. We also built stuff around using other materials that come very close to the body. So you might know this already, but there's a lot of technology that we strap onto the body these days, and there will be even more. In the future, as you grow old, you might be, you know, wiped in the butt by a robot. And so we need to figure out how to let these machines come very close to our bodies with dignity and also with interesting experiences. So here, one of my PhD students has built this material. She calls it Omnifiber. So basically, you can weave these tubings into cloth, and then you can fill them with air, or you can fill them with chemical alloys. And as you do, the cloth changes its shape. So here you see a corset made out of this material that you see it can squeeze your ribs, it can squeeze your belly, it can squeeze over your... But you could, you know, use this for any body part. And one of the things that she created with this was... together with, again, an opera singer. I don't know why we end up with these opera singers, but her name is Kelsey, and she wanted to perform a particular piece called Three Voices by Morten Feldman, and she wanted the corset to be like the fourth voice. So as she's singing with these three voices, she wanted the corset to perform on the audience. So here's the audience. We're only three of us. It's kind of expensive to build these things, so sometimes we only build a few of them. Anyway, so here we are. It's Madeline and me and Claudia experiencing both listening to Kelsey. She's standing in front of us singing with these two other recorded voices, and at the same time feeling these weird, I don't know, orchestrated haptics on top of our body. You know, you look at it and you go like, what? What is going on? What are they feeling? And so to really get deep with someone's experience, we use methods like microphenomenological interview techniques. This builds on Varela and later Claire Petit-Mangin in Paris. So it's a particular interview technique where you can go deep into an experience and really explore, like in a microscope, little experiences in detail. So we haven't published this yet, but here is an account of my experience, part of my experience, a very tiny part. It is towards the end of this 30-minute long performance. When I talk about it in my interview, I say it was so beautiful what Kelsey was singing. Her voice was going out towards the windows. It felt like we were there with all the messiness of the room, all of these things going on. The two recorded voices were there. They were doing their thing, and we were like, by that time, kind of exhausted. And then suddenly her voice comes on with all its beauty. She was singing more beautifully than before. I often think that she was doing her part in this piece, adjusting to fit, but now it felt like she was really using her whole operatic voice. And so it was rising, going up, out, leaving us. And that's where I started crying, because it was so moving. It was like this beautiful, fragile, human, beautiful, especially beautiful voice that was going up, out. So the mechanical workings of this thing on my body was contrasted in a super interesting way by the beauty of the human voice. And it felt like the corset was dying on my body and Kelsey was leaving us through the window. Oh, I was like, meh. There you go. Anyway, so that's what I do at work every now and then. Another example of stuff that we created is working a lot around women's health, because it's provocative and interesting, isn't it? And so, for example, using similar shape-shifting materials as the corset, but now we put them into a chair, we can make the user more aware of their pelvic floor muscle. So for those of you in the audience who are women and who've given birth, you know that they tell you to train your pelvic floor muscle. And you go like, yeah, where is it? I don't know where it is and what can I do with it? And again, working with Richard, at some point you told us, yeah, actually you can tense your pelvic floor muscle 12 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 3 o'clock. Try it. Can you? Yeah, where is it? You're sitting, you know, you should be able to feel it and be able to tense it, but also release it. And of course, this is super difficult. It's inside of the body. So we built this for women. And what the chair does is first it pushes you into the right position. So it tilts your pelvis a little bit, poof. It puts your legs apart. So there are shape-shifting elements in these, the block in between your legs, and then slowly it approaches the very sensitive parts and sort of pushing at that to make you really feel like, am I relaxing or am I tensing the muscle? Most of us, to look good, we tense it all the time. We want to look like thin. And so the problem we have is not the tension, it is releasing it, letting the whole thing go, right? Like babies. But other stuff we've done around the women's health and women's bodies is for young women who start menstruating, you know, the menarche, it's called when you start menstruating, it's really hard to understand what is going on. We were talking about this at the dinner yesterday. It's like huge transformation of the body for women. And a lot of women, at the time Adidas had approached us, and they said a lot of young girls will stop doing sports at this point in time because your body is changing so much. And so it's really hard to continue to do sports. Anyway, so how do you get to know your body and understand what is going on over a whole month of you know, from menstruation to the time of the month where you are fertile, when the egg goes, and so on. So we made a bunch of, we call them probes, little technological things that you can use to probe your own understanding of your own body. So there's blood. So a lot of women do not touch their own blood and do not try to figure out what is this blood, but maybe we should. Well, I stopped menstruating by now, but when I was still menstruating, right? So that's blood. And what you do is you take a little sample from down there and you put it on a little thing on top of your mobile and you use the mobile camera to enlarge it and see what's going on. The middle picture is actually saliva. And you might not know this, but when you're fertile, your saliva has this crystalline pattern. So you take a little bit of your saliva and put it on the mobile microscope, and you can see that. And then you can go like, oh, right, it's only 2 days a month, isn't it, that you're really fertile. And then we have this shape-shifting elements that you can use to have a little bit of a massage over your, you know, when you have cramps, if you have cramps, and so on and so on. And then we had some women or girls use this for a whole month to explore what is going on to become more body aware of your menstruation cycle, which is of course crucial in a woman's life to understand and to work with and not against, maybe. We also invited these young girls to design with us. So sometimes these some aesthetic transformations are not only to do with using something that somebody else built for you, but maybe actively participating in building stuff that makes sense to you. So we gave them semi-ready-made materials, and then they designed a bunch of things. And I guess we were assuming that it would be mainly about this part of the body, where there are cramps and pain and whatnot. But the middle picture is really about breathing. So that girl, she said, no, I really want something to help me relax and not go like, yeah, PMS, you know, that time of the month where you want to kill your husband and throw things on the floor, yeah. But, you know, handling that and working with that. So designing is another path, right? Another project is by Carrie Helms. She gave birth during her PhD studies and became super interested in how, where does the body end and where does it start, right? So if you're breastfeeding, it suddenly is like, what? Where is me and where is the baby and where is the milk and where is the portholes to my body? So she's been working not only with breast milk, but also with peeing and other bodily fluids as a way of going back and forth between inner and outer and what it means to be a body or a soma that is not clearly in one place or the other. And here you see some of her breast milk stuff that she built. And that's her daughter's hand holding on to it. So here we're working with what some of you might refer to as more than human bodies, the post-phenomenological concepts, and trying to engage with designing with other materials than the harsh technical materials, but also designing with menstruation blood, saliva, pee, blood, moss, and so on. And partly for also sustainability reasons, right? We want our stuff to be such that we can unmake it and then make it biodegradable, right? So that you build stuff that you put in the ground and it goes away. So unfortunately, 5,000 years from now, you will not be able to see these because they will be gone, right? But that's what we're interested in right now. So shifting from digital materials that are made out of transistors and whatnot and silicon to interactive materials that are in other biological forms. Okay, so those were just some examples. So let me just talk a little bit about how do we do this? How do we come to these kinds of designs? And so I'll just go quickly through. So we work a lot with what we call first-person methods. So in my field, in human-computer interaction, that was a big taboo. You don't use yourself in design. You're supposed to design for other people. How can you put yourself in there and believe that you are a normal user? You're not. You need to engage with your end user. You need to do user-centered design. So when we started working with these methods where you are experiencing and you're using your own body as part of the design project, then this was questioned a lot in my field. I had huge difficulties getting my stuff published originally. But then step by step, we figured out ways of presenting this and working with this that made sense to my field. And now, finally, I was asked yesterday, are you accepted now? And I think, yeah, this year, maybe I am, in fact. But just to say a few words about that, if you look at what Merleau-Ponty says about these perspectives, it's not, when I say first-person method, I don't mean solely that the design process is about my inner experience. Of course, that is there. I use that a lot. But I also design together with other people and sometimes together with our end users, but from a felt perspective. So it's not like I observe them as if they're under some microscope, but rather I try to feel empathically what they feel. And so the grasping the meaning of the other's expression through feeling it is what we strive to do, not easy. And when I look at my own body from a third person perspective, when I'm like, oh, here's a hand, oh, I can do this with my hand, I wonder what I, you know, then I also feel it from the inside, right? So there's this double sensation. And that is what we use when we design. So we try to dissolve, in a way, these perspectives. So here we have a design project we did on balancing on a balance beam. And we wanted to let end users experience that without having to be on a real rope like a ballerina, but as you can see, it's just a plank on the floor. But then we used VR to distort the senses and whatnot. Yeah, all sorts of fun stuff. Anyway, we were trying to figure out what is balancing and when do you go off balance. And so we started with trying to walk on this plank with blindfolded and, you know, this and that, in order to really feel what is it to be in balance or holding your balance or working with balance. And then we put a muscle sensor that we could move around on the muscles of you know, the calf or by the ankle and so on. And we translated that muscle data, sensor data, into sound. So then we could hear the muscle tensing or releasing, like me. And depending on where we put it, suddenly we could almost predict what when somebody was about to fall. So we could see exactly which muscles were involved in the balance and very much how it came from the feet, from the ball of the feet. And so that moment would we, so this is my colleague Charles, he's working on this and he's got the sensor on, and we could hear his muscle working. And so we could share in a second person perspective his experience in a sense. And the discovery, the design discovery for us was like, ooh, we could use this to do interesting interactions when we know somebody's about to fall, right? So for us, Soma Design has become a way of exploring all of these perspectives, the first person inside, closing your eyes, feeling stuff, the second person watching others, trying to empathically understand, and the third person shifting to the outside view of your own body, and then dissolving that. And by doing so, that's where this becomes strange, you know, in the terms of estrangement. And whenever there's that kind of gap, there is this looseness of imagination, and that is where design ideas somehow flourish. I don't know how to explain it in any other way, but that is what we do. So I think I'll just skip, you know, a lot of our work is then doing stuff in the strange way, like if you interlace your fingers, and then you do it the other way around, you know. So that is where you go like, whoa, that's weird, or this, and then you do this. Yeah. There's been so much talking at this conference, very little doing. Now do it with me, okay? Do this. And then you do it the other way around. Okay, when you do it in the unfamiliar, in the strange way, that's when you can get hold of what's going on here. Or push your chin in one direction and your tongue in the other. Now do it the other way around. Any which way. So that is what we work with. And this is not only disrupting these very sort of simple behaviors, but also disrupting norms, disrupting, you know, traditions, structures, systems, physically, conceptually, and so on. And that's where we get design ideas. So let me skip that. So to us, what Soma Design has offered is a way of bridging this kind of body-mind divide, which was badly needed for my field. Because a lot of work is very oppressive towards the body, very oppressive, very like disciplining the body, putting sensors on to keep the body in shape and being perfect and healthy and whatnot. So instead, really recognizing how bodily movement, emotion and thinking and sociality are connected, and ways of then attending to the inner universe, but also dissolving the inside from the outside, or the individual from the social, or the body from technology. So it becomes this entanglement or intercorporality between us and the technology, a drone. I tried to draw a drone here. So my nervous system endings are suddenly entangled with what the drone is doing, and we become one sometimes. Sometimes we fail, but sometimes I can act together with the technology I built. So that was my main message, that what I tried to write about in my book after spending some time with Richard in Florida, for which I'm forever grateful. Soma design is this path to examining and improving on the connections among sensation, feeling, emotion, and subjective understanding and values. And as all of you know, I usually have to explain this, but for this audience, I guess it doesn't need to be explained, that, you know, you work with Dewey's ideas of emptying the material of all its potential, touching it, feeling it, engaging with it, so that you can design interesting stuff. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your interesting lecture. We got some examples from pragmatic and practice Soma aesthetics. And here the floor is open for the questions, remarks. We have more than 10 minutes.
I don't know if this question directly to you, but it opens a lot of discussion I'm personally very much interested in, because I'm a person in a who is in a chronic pain all the time from my back and trying everything to fix myself, and it gives me a big transformation dealing with it. Mm. So I'm very interested in this kind of designs. Mm. So I'm happy to hear your talk. I'm curious about, like, you were asking in the beginning of your talk that how do we get to the promise of Soma aesthetics? So, like, most of us have some problems, some discomfort that we should work on ourselves, like that we should try some somatic practices. But I can observe some people are, like, not aware of it. They are suffering, but they don't do anything at all. I'm seeing this kind of people so much because I'm already very alert to this thing. And I'm seeing the person, she's very close to me, and I am seeing that the way she uses her feet, the shoulder, and she's complaining a lot, but how to, like, whose duty is mm-hmm. that to, like, wake this person up, and mm-hmm. should it be something coming from inside? I mean, are you doing all these discussions for ourselves? Because I'm learning a lot for myself, what I can do, how I can improve my being. Mm. But what about the others? Mm. Are we trying to help also the others? So this is my question, but yeah. I don't know where to find the answer exactly.
Well, for me, it was very important in Rich's definition of Soma aesthetics that he talks about agency, subjectivity, that it needs to be, you need to actively engage, right? And so I'm not so sure you can help your friend unless he or she has that kind of agency and willingness to go into that. And I think this is also so important, because a lot of work on design is almost like we could decide what the end user is going to feel, and we can't. We have to rely on the subjective engagement, the agency of somebody, to the willingness to transform. But I would also like to say two more things about pain. So one is that Richard is going to host a little workshop or conference on pain in November in Florida. bodies in pain, so maybe that's worth attending. And the other is I have a visiting PhD student from the Estonian Art Academy who's built, I don't know how to express it, installations on your body that lets you experience what it is like to have pain. And so she, for example, has this big blobby thing that you put on your shoulders, and as you move, it makes squeaky sounds like, you know, so it's a way of understanding also the connections. So if your friend would be interested and willing, there could be ways of going into that experience and feeling what a transformation might be. The problem is, of course, that it takes time and engagement and so on. So this is why we did that study over 3 months, because these changes, they can be in the moment super enlightening, and sometimes that lingers, but you also need to work with it if you have the kind of pain that you're talking about, I would say. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Other questions?
First of all, thank you, Kia, for your work, which gives the whole project a great deal more legitimacy than another book, another article, etc. Something is very clear in your presentation, but maybe it's helpful to make it explicit to this audience, and that's the teamwork in design, that the a kind of group body of, and you know, that's an important part of the project, because in design, you're working as a group, you need to feel comfortable together. Yeah. And I know a big part of your process, design process, is getting people to feel together those things.
Yeah.
And not only to feel together an object, but to feel together as a group.
Yeah.
Right? And so that's something that, you know, I think is very important, and maybe not so clear to philosophers who sit in a room with a book and work on their own. And I guess the other thing is, it comes together in the process, but for some publics, it's important to kind of articulate what I see as two aspects of Soma Aesthetics and design, or Soma design. One is like the ideation process of generating ideas through those bodily experiences. And the other would be actually creating the prototypes that work towards cultivating body awareness. Because the ideation process can be also directed to other products rather than ones that are just, you know, focused on some aesthetic cultivation. So maybe just add to that or talk about your experience.
Yeah, so working together, I just wanted to, because I pre-prepared, what are we doing right now? So one of the things, one of the latest things we wrote about this is the teamwork and how important the teamwork is and how vulnerable you are in teamwork, and how actually you want to be vulnerable. If you're going to not be the standoffish kind of designer who goes like, yeah, I'm designing for someone else and I'm doing this little, you know, whatever, mobile app, and they'll just go register how many steps they do per day, and I don't have to engage with myself and my own experience of that or with their experience, then that's one situation. If you're trying to design with your whole self, with other people in the room, you need to expose yourself. And in academia, in I'm working at a technical university, you know, they're like, what are you doing? You're rolling about on the floor together, you're talking about your emotions, you're like, you know, sharing stuff. How can you do that? And I think it's also a legitimate question, because if I make myself vulnerable and expose myself in this way, we also need to be able to take care of that. So I've had people break down in our sessions crying because we touch on something that is important. Or pain, lots of pain. People suddenly, after shutting off for a long while, they feel it and they go like, wow, this is overwhelming. And they suddenly feel very sort of vulnerable, is for a better word. And so I think the ethics of this is super important. If we're going to go here, we need to take care of one another, ourselves and one another, and we need to build trust. And it takes time. And at first you are like, oh, this is so much fun, I'm doing this weird stuff. And then you have to get over that and come into a situation where you're seriously attending to your own somatic reactions. And I think that ethical consideration is not only for the design team, but also if I build one of these systems and I put it out into the world, as a designer, I need to take responsibility for what it does in the world, which is not easy because people will use it in different ways with their different experiences and whatnot. But that's my ethical responsibility. And ethics, as I understand it, I'm not 100% sure, but in the somesthetic context, ethics is about everything you do, every movement, every... mundane daily activity, what does it do to you, to the world, to other people around you? So yeah, that is one of the questions we are exploring, how to do that as a group.
Okay, so I was always surprised that one of the fields where we are really active, sport, is a little bit not missing in your somatic world, but it seems to be not so important. So have you already thought of creating some gadgets for sportsmen, not necessarily for profis, but amateurs? Or
yeah.
Because
yeah, so we have, not in my group, but we have done, there is work around sports. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the somatic project is a little bit at odds with some of the practices of sports. So you have to enter that space with care. We've also done stuff. The latest thing we did a couple of weeks ago, we went to Nottingham and we did collisions. So if you watch a rugby game, they're like, "Ooh," right? And that's part of the what you enjoy, right? You want to see that. You want to like, oh, he's going to collide and boom, right? And so we were doing work around colliding with robots. Okay, so we are going to live, or we are already living with robots. I don't know if you've seen them in restaurants and, you know, they're everywhere. They're at, the assembly lines in factories and so on. There are robots. And people collide with these robots. And that's interesting. How can we do that in an interesting manner? How can we deep dive into the anticipation of a collision and then, boom, colliding? So we used VR stuff. We had this virtual wall. So you look through your VR goggles and you're like, oh, there's a virtual wall and you're supposed to walk towards it. But then there's also a physical wall and you don't know if the physical wall is behind the virtual wall, in front of the virtual wall, or aligned with the virtual wall. So you're like, ha, ha, ha. So we do stuff like that. Yes, we do engage not only with the pleasant and nice, or the meditative. We also do stuff around the uncomfortable, the exhilarating, the sports stuff. And I wish we would do stuff around fashion, but we don't yet. We should be, because I think that's super interesting.
Thanks a lot. Other questions?
Otherwise, I'll tell you about my two other... So one is exploring this ethics. Another one is the validity. So which ones of these methods that we use, the estrangement methods or the Feldenkrais or whatever, which ones of these are actually helping shape the designs we do? So validity to a designer is not the same as proving with some kind of statistical methods. It is about whether the theoretical and practical ways of doing stuff is generative, if it generates design ideas or not. And I think I've proven that in this talk, sort of. But is it also transferable? Can someone else pick up these methods, or is it us as designers? We happen to be good at it and other people are not. And also, what is the scope? Does it work for sports? Does it work for everyday work environment? Does it work for even designing graphical user interfaces and so on? That's where we're probing. So one of our projects now is with Volvo, doing an interactive seat for autonomous driving cars, where the seat is a bit like the pelvic floor chair. The seat is shifting to wake you up so that you can grab the wheel again when you stop sort of just sleeping and going with the autonomous vehicle. And then the final project is, it's to do with that, trying to figure out what the domains are that we should be exploring next. So Volvo, working with Volvo to do commercial stuff. You know, in my world, it's super interesting. We were applying for funding for this pelvic floor chair, and they're like, nah, you know, it's heartwarming, but it's a bit niche, isn't it? And you go like, what the hell? This is 50% of the population. But no, they're like, yeah, it's a bit niche, isn't it? And then you apply for almost the same idea, but you put it in a car, and then you get the funding. Because it's like, oh, yeah, but this is something everyone can relate to, right? It's a car. So that's my world. This is the computer science world. So both that, but also exploring stuff around intimate touch, being very close to the body. As I said before, you know, about technologies that will wipe our butt when we grow old, or technologies like exoskeletons that will make you into this machine, right? A soldier or a machine in a working factory with extra strength because you have this extra skeleton on top of your body that makes you stronger and makes you, allows you to go further and so on. And so we really want to explore that more with dignity.
Maybe a robot that will touch you in diagnosis much nicer and more sensitive than your doctor and nurses today. That's something that I'm also very interested in.
Yeah.
And one other thing, Alex, there's a new book that came out last month on somesthetics and sports. So there's a whole collection on it. And Botan has a copy of the book. I'll ask him to, or you can ask him to bring it tomorrow.
Thank you very much. This was the place of the advertisement. Thank you for your lecture.
Thank you.
And we have some minutes break before the next session.